Good morning and welcome to our service. The theme of our worship today is living with our longings. And it asks the question of why is it that we all find within us deep, indefinable longings that, despite the best that life gives us, still remain unfulfilled? Could it be that we've been looking for the answer in all the wrong places? Well, our call to worship comes from Psalm 37. Do not fret because of those who are evil, or be envious of those who do wrong. For like the grass, they'll soon wither. Like green plants, they'll soon die away. Trust in the Lord and do good. Dwell in the land and enjoy safe pasture. Take delight in the Lord, and He will give you the desires of your heart. Commit your way to the Lord, trust in Him, and He will do this. Let us pray. Help us, O Lord, to open wide the window of our spirits, that we may be filled with light. Help us to open wide the door of our hearts, that we may receive you with all our powers of adoration. Teach us to so contemplate you that we may become like you and love you sincerely and simply as you love us, that we may find in you that which our hearts most deeply desire. Amen. Young, one of my favourite songs was that classic hit, first recorded by Margaret Whiteling in 1948, I think it was, and it was the hit Faraway Places with Strange Sounding Names. And it became so popular that other famous singers like Bing Crosby and Vera Lynn also recorded it. Now the lyrics go like this. Faraway places with strange sounding names, far away over the sea. Those faraway places with the strange sounding names are calling me. Go into China or maybe Siam, I want to see for myself those faraway places I've been reading about in a book that I took from the shelf. They call me a dreamer, well maybe I am, but I know that I'm burning to see those faraway places with the strange sounding names calling me. Now, when I reached my mid-teens, those faraway places had crystallized in my imagination into two parts of the world. The first was Australia, or more particularly, Outback Australia, and the other was the islands of the South Seas. And I particularly remember my last night in England before our family sailed to Australia. It was 2 days before my 16th birthday. We were all feeling very sad and lonely as we turned our backs on everything we'd known and faced a future filled with hope, but also with trepidation. So my parents took us to the movies that night, and they took us to see that Cinerama classic called South Seas Adventure. And it follows the stories of five groups of people travelling across the fabled South Seas, all the way from Hawaii to Tahiti and on to Australia, ending up with a migrant family driving across western New South Wales to Broken Hill. Well, that did the trick. I returned to our hotel that night filled with excitement that at last I was on my way to that part of the world that epitomised those faraway places. However, when I eventually got to visit the Australian outback and later on the islands of the South Seas, even though initially I found them exciting and exotic, I discovered that the sense of wonder I'd expected to feel within myself just wasn't there. It was like that classic scene from the movie Shirley Valentine, where Shirley, facing the reality of middle age and the end of her dreams, gets to fulfill her lifelong dream of leaving the dreariness of Liverpool and have a holiday on a Greek island. And there, sitting alone outside a taverna, watching the sunset, she's joined by Costas, the owner. And he understands exactly what she's feeling, and he says, "Ah, dreams, they are never where you think they are." C.S. Lewis spoke about this universal human experience when he wrote, "Now, most people, if they really learned to look into their own hearts, would know that they do want, and they want acutely, something that cannot be had in this world. There are all sorts of things in this world that offer to give it to you, but they never quite keep their promise. The longings which arise in us when we first fall in love, or first think of some foreign country, or first take up some subject that excites us, they're all longings which no marriage, no travel, no learning can really satisfy. And if I find in myself a desire which no experience in this world can satisfy, the most probable explanation is that I was made for another world." Well, I've entitled this sermon, Living With Our Longings. Why is it that we have such deep longings within us that seem doomed to failure, destined to remain unfulfilled? Saint Augustine gave the answer when he said, "You've made us for yourself, O Lord, and our heart is restless until it rests in you." The answer is, we were made for another world. We were made for God, and the purpose of our being is now to grow into that reality. And there are two verses of scripture that have always spoken deeply to me in this respect. The first is Psalm 37, verse 4, "Take delight in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart." And the second, Philippians 1, 21, where Paul says, "For me, to live is Christ and to die is gain."
Our reading today is Philippians 1, verses 20 to 26, Paul's life for Christ. "For I fully expect and hope that I will never be ashamed, but that I will continue to be bold for Christ as I have been in the past. And I trust that my life will bring honor to Christ, whether I live or die. For to me, living means living for Christ, and dying is even better. But if I live, I can do more fruitful work for Christ, so I really don't know which is better. I'm torn between two desires. I long to go and be with Christ, which would be far better for me. But for your sakes, it's better that I continue to live. Knowing this, I am convinced that I will remain alive so I can continue to help all of you grow and experience the joy of your faith. And when I come to you again, you'll have even more reason to take pride in Christ Jesus because of what he's doing through me."
I heard the
Church had a saying that life is a bridge. You cross over it, but you don't build your house on it. And it reminds us that we're only travellers through this life. Our true home lies beyond it. Here we have no continuing city, but we seek the city that is to come. That's how the book of Hebrews puts it. And it's so easy when things are going well to wish that it might all go on forever. But of course it doesn't. And it's often hard times, or takes hard times, to remind us that we are pilgrims on a journey, just passing through. And that's how the Apostle Paul looked at life. Life to him was a journey full of purpose, but the best part of it was anticipating the final destination. To me, he said, to live is Christ, but to die is gain. Now, one of the great themes of the Bible is pilgrimage. Life is not a destination. It's a journey to a greater life. It's there in the Old Testament account of the Israelites journeying through the desert, guided and sustained by God until they reach their promised land. It's in the story of their ancestors, Abraham, Isaac, Jacob, and Joseph, who, as the book of Hebrews says, admitted that they were strangers on earth and they were longing for a better country, a heavenly one. And it's in the teaching of Jesus, who says to us, in my Father's house are many rooms. I'm going there to prepare a place for you, that you also may be where I am. Now, it's very easy for us, burdened as we are by the cares of daily life, to forget all this and to be able to see nothing more than the next bill we have to pay or ailment we have to endure or loved one we have to worry about. And it's also easy for us to forget that because we become so absorbed in this life, and the accumulation of things and prestige and the pleasure and ultimate meaning in life, make that all the ultimate meaning in life. And Jesus warned against this when he said, your lives do not consist in the abundance of your possessions. Many of the old hymns express this very well, this theme of life being a journey to a promised land. Hymns like, guide me, O thou great Jehovah, pilgrim through this barren land. And those beautiful Negro spirituals like Swing Low Sweet Chariot Coming to Carry Me Home. Now they were sung by generations that understood that this life, whatever it brings, is only transitory. We're all travellers who choose either to follow the narrow path that leads more fully into the spiritual life we were created for, or to choose the broad path of self-absorption that kills it. For to me, to live is Christ, and to die is gain, wrote the Apostle Paul. And he went on to say, I'm torn between the two. I desire to depart and be with Christ, which is better by far, but it's more necessary for you that I remain in the body. I've often come across that same feeling, being torn between wanting to cling to life and also wanting to go on. People have told me about glimpses of eternity they've had, times when they've been close to death, and the greatest disappointment for them was when they were actually revived. I remember being at my sister's bedside just before she died and hearing my niece say, it feels like the room's full of people. And then seeing my sister sit up, smiling and waving to people that I couldn't see, but she obviously could. And I wondered then, as I do now, if this was that great cloud of witnesses that the Bible says surrounds the people of God. And now for our prayers.
Let's pray. Faithful God, thank you for being with us now and every moment of our lives. We know, God, that you have called us to a journey of faith. Guide our lives and our steps as we walk this journey, inward and outward. Help us discern what you would have us do as we follow in your way. Help us be brave enough to look inside and see those things that are holding us back from being who you, God, created us to be. Thank you for loving us into wholeness. Gracious and generous God, you are a God of compassion and love. Time after time, we have experienced your care and provision. Time after time, you've answered our prayers and met our needs, often in ways that we could never have dreamed possible. We praise you for your faithful love toward us, for the blessings that you have bestowed on us. Because we have known your love, we come to you with confidence, offering our prayers for the world you love. Oh God, we pray this day for all those who have a song they cannot sing, for all those who have a burden they cannot bear, for those who are sick, and for those who tend them, for those who live in hunger, and for those who will not share their bread, for those who are misunderstood, and for those who misunderstand, for those whose words of love are locked in their hearts, and for those who yearn to hear those words. We come to you today with so many burdens and concerns on our hearts. Help us to be open to your words of healing and restoration. Hear us now as we bring before you in the silence those who are on our hearts today. You have done great things for us, God of great love. You make a way through our brokenness, so hope might be restored. You loosen our grip on fear so that we might take hold of the one who cradles us in the palms of grace. You make a way through our doubt so we may have the faith to follow on your pilgrim way. You gather up our tears, turning them into fountains of joy. Thank you for bringing us healing and hope, restoration, and renewal of life. Gracious and loving God, open our eyes to see you. Open our ears to hear you. Open our hearts to love you. And open our hands to serve you as we follow on your pilgrim way. And hear us now as we pray together the prayer that your Son taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us in the time of trial, and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen.
There's a lovely poem by Wordsworth called Intimations of Immortality, and it goes like this. Our birth is but a sleep and a forgetting. The soul that rises with us, our life star, hath had elsewhere its setting and cometh from afar. Not in entire forgetfulness and not in utter nakedness, but trailing clouds of glory do we come from God, who is our home. Hence, in a season of calm weather, though inland far we be, our souls have sight of that immortal sea, which brought us hither, can in a moment travel thither, and see the children sport upon the shore, and hear the mighty waters rolling evermore. Those words remind me of those poignant words from the book of Ecclesiastes that say, God has set eternity in our hearts. And there are times when we catch a fleeting glimpse of it, and we know that we are destined for something far more than the limitations of this present life. A few moments ago, I referred to people who had had near-death experiences, and most of them report having initially had a desperate desire to get back into the body, which then changed to a desire not to go back, and actually great disappointment when they discovered they had. The effect of this on most of them is quite transforming. They become more reflective, more concerned about ultimate issues and less about material things, stressing the importance of living lives of love for others and seeking understanding. It's the sort of longing expressed in the words of that old gospel song that says, "I can't feel at home in this world anymore." Now, to me, those stories sound similar to what Paul described when he talked about a man he knows who was caught up to paradise and heard inexpressible things that human words cannot describe. Now, it's often thought he was referring to his own experience when he was left for dead by a mob outside the town of Lystra. No wonder he summarized his life by saying, "For me to live is Christ and die is gain." Because eventually, we'll all die physically. And the only thing that will matter is what we are, not what position we achieved or what wealth we accumulated. All that we will take with us is who we are at the very core of our being, and those three eternal qualities of faith, hope, and love. I had an army friend in Brisbane whom I went to see after I heard his father had died. Now, his dad was a wonderful old man of faith, well into his 90s, but very frail. And Stacey told me how he got to his father's hospital bed just moments before the old man died. And he said, "I took Dad's hand and I told him I was there. And he opened his eyes and he recognized me. He was too weak to speak, but he just squeezed my hand and looked up at the ceiling with a big smile on his face and pointed upwards with his other hand. And then he closed his eyes and went to be with the Lord." Well, I think that's the way I'd like to go. To live is Christ, and to die is gain. And when that's our philosophy of life, it doesn't matter whether the stock market's booming or collapsing. It doesn't matter about pandemics or anything. Not if our health is improving or failing. The point is, we are pilgrims on a journey, and this present life is merely a bridge that we're travelling across. Our true life lies beyond. friends, I'm going to conclude our service this morning by inviting you to join with me in Holy Communion. Now, if you're not prepared for this, perhaps you might just like to stop your recording at this moment, put it on pause, go and get yourself a little bit of bread, some juice or some wine, and then return and join with me. And so the peace of the Lord be always with you. Friends, this is the table of the Lord, and he calls us to this sacred feast. Come not because you are strong, but because you are weak. Come not because of any goodness of your own, but because you need mercy and help. Come because you love the Lord a little and would like to love him more. Come because he loves you and gave himself for you. Lift up your hearts and minds above your cares and fears, and let this bread and wine be to you the sign and pledge of the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit. On the night that Jesus was betrayed, he took bread and he broke it, and he gave it to his disciples, saying, "This is my body given for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood, which is poured out for you. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Let us pray. Be present, risen Lord Jesus, by your Holy Spirit, as you were with your disciples, and make yourself known to us in the breaking of the bread, for you live and reign with the Father and the Holy Spirit, one God forever and ever. Amen. And now, friends, the body and blood of our Lord Jesus Christ keep us in eternal life. And now the blessing. The peace of God, which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge of God and of his Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord. And the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be amongst you and remain with you always. Amen.